formed ways of taking decisions. And so when the policy drafting committee was in the process of its work and had come up with what was defined as the decisions in the making, it was sent to all the presbyteries. We would like to thank all the presbyteries who took extraordinary action to discuss it. We were able to finish that work before three of the presbyteries met in their synod, and so they received the original copies before the synods and discussed it in their synods. All the others called special meetings in order to discuss it. And to date, we have received 14 feedback from 14 presbyteries, including our Europe presbytery. So only two did not respond back to us. I will not name those presbyteries. But this means that the document before you has gone to the presbyteries, you have discussed it, and when the feedback came, the committee took into consideration every single presbytery's concerns, and they were incorporated into this document you see before you. You will see yourselves in it if you sent feedback. There is also a long list of 22 items which you will be glad to note that we will not read for you. We'll be reading only pages 1 to 5. The topic of that long list should have come on top of page 6. The topic is at the bottom of page 5. It says, a bank of points made by presbyteries. The presbyteries in your responses made a number of points.
Which of the papers are you referring to?
Recommendations for policy decisions. So if you have in front of you recommendations for policy decisions.
Yeah, the one title, recommendations for policy decisions.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's our main document we are working with.
Okay.
And I'm just talking about the process first. So, many of the points raised in the presbyteries we were able to accommodate in revising the main document. The others we felt were good points, but some of them were new points that did not have anything to do with the points already recommended. Therefore, we call them a bank of points made by presbyteries. They are not for action in this presbytery, but we did want to honor the fact that presbyteries took time to make these points. So if in future policy-making processes they come in, that would be a good thing, but it's not for today. We just didn't want any presbytery to feel we discussed this and our points were just ignored. So, moderator, I will not actually say more about that than I have said now, just so that we know what the process is. Moderator, I'll now proceed on behalf of the committee to state the recommendations one by one for action by this august body, the General Assembly of the EP Church Ghana. The status of each one of them, because I'll not be repeating the preface, is being moved by the committee, and we've asked two of our commissioners to be the ones moving. So all the 17 points, just bear in mind that each one is moved by the Reverend W.K. Domi and seconded by Presbyter Gladys Fedi Achian. So that's the status for recorders to note. Number one. And if you have that document before you, you'll follow with me. That the General Assembly receive with appreciation the address of the moderator and commend it to the presbyteries and districts for study and action. The General Assembly notes especially the stress on the elements of EPCH strategic plans that need to be implemented, as well as implications of the theme, improving upon our gains through selflessness, integrity, and effective stewardship. The General Assembly therefore urges the Church at all levels to be diligent in the following. A, in accordance with the EPCG corporate strategic plans and the call to be faithful to God in impacting our communities, pastors, catechists, evangelists, presbyters, women and men, youth and children, that is youth, not youth, and children, need to identify and eliminate our weaknesses at all levels, capitalize on opportunities and mitigate the threats as expressed in the EPCG vision, mission, core values, selflessness, integrity, and stewardship laid out in our corporate strategic plans. To this end, all presbyteries should take the opportunities available for training and retraining of church agents on the strategic plans and use of monitoring and reporting mechanisms. Two, General Assembly and presbytery leadership should be vigilant in tracking of the strategic plan to ensure congregations are living out the church's vision and mission and core values, and that all spheres of the church work together as one corporate body. Three, the church should be more visible on national issues on peace, as well as economic and social issues in the country. B, exercise effective stewardship at all levels of the church as persons who hold our positions in trust for God. Each leader and member should be good stewards in the positions we are called to serve in. The resources we have, human and material, as well as the time we have, and be diligent in adhering to the laid down policies and plans of the church, including the monitoring tools outlined in our strategic plans. That stewardship education should not be limited to the month of January. C, the church reaffirms its constitutional connectional polity that links congregations with districts, presbyteries, and the general assemblies, and condemns the tendency for certain congregations to act as congregational churches. Presbytery synod leaders should monitor districts and congregations who deviate from this and apply directives, and where necessary, reprimand and/or apply sanctions to pastors and congregations which violate this principle. D, to intercede for a free, fair, and violence-free election before, during, and after the December 7 presidential and parliamentary election in Ghana. And E, in this era of COVID-19, the church needs to exercise wisdom at all levels. One, worshiping in a healthy environment following all the COVID-19 protocols for as long as necessary. Two, the congregations which are able should continue to offer online services and use electronic means to reach minister to people, even as people returning to worship together in sanctuaries. Even as people are returning to worshiping together in sanctuaries. Three, being prudent in managing finances to ensure the financial limitations caused by COVID-19 do not adversely affect the church. And four, increasing education around good stewardship in order to recover some of the financial losses due to COVID-19. Moderator, commissioners will recognize all these as part of your welcome address today. The action we are voting on is for us to accept, to receive it. And we've tabulated the specific policies that come out of it for action.
Thank you very much. As has been read, it's very clear to us. I therefore put the question that all in favor of this policy, will say aye. Thank you. We move on to the second one.
Okay. Yes. Moderator, the second one. We have the General Assembly Council, now the General Assembly Executive Council report in our books. In ordinary times, in our report books, in ordinary times, we would have had a gist of it read for us, and the Assembly's duty is to receive it. And so we are taking that action. You will agree with me that for a one-day General Assembly, we cannot have the whole thing read for us. So take it on trust. You have it for you. You will be able to read it. But now you are being called upon to receive it. So two, receive the General Assembly Council report with gratitude for all the work done by the General Assembly Council. The ninth General Assembly notes that the points of policy development from the General Assembly Council report are resulting in at least three of the policies before the General Assembly. Needs to be scratched. It's not relevant anymore. But there are some specific points. A, for future General Assemblies, the GAC report should include an account of how the church at various levels are implementing the strategic plans. This part of the report should be based on the reports General Assembly Council receives from each presbytery and church groups, as well as units of operation. Two, the presbytery reports should be based on the reports they have received from the districts. B, that General Assembly Council should strengthen policy implementation by ensuring that presbytery moderators do their work of certifying the implementation of the church's policies. C, the internal audit function of ensuring policies are adhered to should be enforced. Moderator, these recommendations actually were gleaned from the presbytery responses we received to the draft that we sent to the presbyteries. And apparently they gleaned this in order to help the church. And so these are the recommendations we put. The first is to receive the report, but also to note the points A, B, and C as policies that are being put in place.
Thank you very much. It has been explained already that these policies are coming out of this. In normal time, clerk will have we at the podium reading all this out for us. But the reports have been sent and they have taken out this for us to enforce, and that the reports to General Assembly should be action oriented, and what is happening in the presbytery. These things have been read to us. So all in favor of this policy, respond aye. Thank you. Those not in favor, say nay. None, the ayes have it.
Okay.
Let's move on.
Moderator, point three is the same as the General Assembly Council report. In ordinary times, EBDRA would have read its report for us. We have it available in the books. So receive the EBDRA report with thanksgiving. The General Assembly urges EBDRA to disseminate information on their operations to enable members of the EPCG to be fully aware of how EBDRA operates and opportunities to be part of the projects. Endorses all the way forward sections of the various sections of the EBDRA report. I pause here to say, if you look at the EBDRA report, after each item, they say the way forward. So it endorses these way forward sections. C, a total restructuring of EBDRA and a strategic plan for the way forward to make it income generating. And D, in addition to EBDRA, other social services such as the clinics should also report to the General Assembly. Again, through EBDRA, but
yes, the EBDRA reports, and these are the policies out for them to look at for the next General Assembly report. So all in favor say aye. Against nay. The ayes have it.
Moderator, number four. The aged ministry should be incorporated into the church's activities, and that a day be set aside by each congregation to celebrate with the aged and the invalid in the church, to celebrate them. This is not a fundraising day. This will make the aged defined here as 70 and above. So I don't qualify yet. In our congregations to feel involved and loved, therefore enhancing their personality. Moderator.
It means as soon as you finish as a pastor, you qualify to be brought to the congregation to celebrate you. pastors and all other members.
Yes.
All in favor say aye. Against nay. Carried. The aye carried. Thank you. Let's move on.
Yes. Moderator, point five has an additional document that has been passed around. You have it in your hands. Presbyteries have discussed this, and it's been brought back, and necessary amendments have been made to it. The actions are what is in this particular point, and so we'll not actually read the paper itself here. It's in your hand so that you can carry it once it is voted into policy.
That's it's a document that has 10 pages.
Yes. It is entitled The New Way Forward for EP Church Finances. Okay. So I understand it's been distributed in presbyteries. It's not every commissioner who would have access to it. But presbyteries, each presbytery has, and the idea is to take it back and start implementing. So I go to the policy as in the original document we are looking at, what we are voting around it. I was quite or at least this committee were quite happy that when the presbyteries brought back their feedback, it was unanimously agreed on in the feedback, that the EP Church adopts a new financial fund gathering policy for the church, that the current means of fulfilling financial obligations to the church based on assessment system should be replaced with a percentage system. This is to ensure that the EPCG utilizes a system which reflects our policy as fairer and makes the church at all levels more sustainable. This document states further details are available in the attached document. So that's what I spoke to. So the actions being called for, apart from adopting it in general, is A, that the policy enshrined in that document be implemented with effect from January 1, 2021. B, that a training team be appointed to train pastors, catechists, treasurers, accountants of presbyteries, and other relevant church personnel in October and November 2020 in 6 locations of the country, which means people in presbyteries close to these locations will have to arrange for these categories of people in the congregations to come. Who? Accra, Tamale, Kumasi, Takoradi, and Ohwe C, that the appropriate monitoring strategies be put in place for this new policy to succeed. Moderator.
Thank you. My understanding is this has been sent to all the presbyteries and they've read it and accepted it. There are other follow-ups to be made as that of appointing of committees. Mm-hmm. Is this to be done by the executive council or we are going to do it here?
No, not here. Not the
here.
Assumptions, as with all policies, once decided, the
then
standing committee takes the lead.
All right.
In
let's accept this. Let's vote on it. All in favor of policy 5, say aye. All those against, nay. All right. Thank you. It's carried.
Okay. 6. That the relationship between the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana and the Presbyterian Church of Ghana be strengthened to include A. high-level bilateral regular meeting at least once a year. B. Joint programs or seminars to address national issues as a contribution from reformed perspectives. C. Strengthen the nature of participation in general assemblies. D. Invitations to one another to attend one another's presbytery level synod meetings. And E. Pulpit exchanges.
Very clear. We have been on it already. So all in favor, say aye. Against, nay. No. Thank you.
Moderator, number 7. The General Assembly adopts the decision of the Bremen Mission Women's Pre-Assembly held in March 2019 in Ghana regarding gender-based violence as follows. A. Denounce the acts of violence and abuse and urge that perpetrators be brought before the law. B. Provide safe spaces for victims, women and children especially. C. Set up telephone or internet counseling or a helpline. D. Train church leaders and agents properly on gender-based violence, noting that gender-based violence is sometimes perpetrated against men also. Moderator.
Thank you. All in favor of policy 7, say aye. Against, nay. It's carried. There you go.
Number 8. The General Assembly adopts the music policy of the church and commend it to the presbyteries, districts, parishes, and congregations for action. That where there are financial implications, example, hiring full-time musicians, local congregations should not feel forced to do so if they cannot afford.
All in favor of policy 8, music, our policy of the church. All in favor, say aye. Against, nay. It's carried. Thank you.
Moderator, number 9. Noting that the 8th General Assembly decision mandating EPCG congregations and districts to operate with only 2 banks had not been implemented, the General Assembly reaffirms for the EPCG congregations and districts to operate only with the named banks and has increased the number to 3. B. Noting that one of the named banks has since become defunct, the General Assembly now names the following 3 banks as the approved banks for the EPCG business. 1. Ghana Commercial Bank. 2. Eco Bank. 3. Agriculture Development Bank. C. These choices are provisional, subject to the packages the banks are ready to give to the EPCG. D. Any exceptions will need to be cleared with the Central Finance Committee of the EPCG. So to explain that part, when policy decisions are made, they are supposed to be carried out by the church. We are the church. The one made 2 years ago was not carried out. It's been reaffirmed. But we are indicating that if any congregation feels there is need not to carry it out, it should ask for an exception. And that exception can only be granted by the CFC, the Central Finance Committee of the EP Church. Moderator.
Thank you. All in favor of policy 9, say aye. All in favor of policy 9, say aye. Against nay. All right, let's move on. Policy 10.
10. Moderator, 10 says ratify the partnership agreement between the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana and the United Reformed Church UK to strengthen the long and strong partnership links between the two churches.
All in favor say aye. Against nay. Yes, policy 11.
Moderator, that the policy document on medical bills of church agents, employees, and employees be adopted. The document will be presented at the General Assembly. It will be given to the presbyteries. It includes such elements as every church agent being registered with the NHIS and also be covered by a life insurance policy that covers serious illnesses.
Thank you. All in favor of the medical policy, say aye. Against nay. Please, it's been adopted. Let's move on.
Moderator, number 12. That the church engages an insurance company to offer life insurance with health insurance components to church agents, pastors, catechists and staff of the church head office, as well as presbytery offices.
All in favor say aye. Against nay. All right, it's carried.
Number 13, that Honours Day be established for distinguished personalities who have served the EPCG. That the Honours Day will be the Sunday after the EP Church Founders Day.
Thank you. A little explanation to that is that this honors mostly is done during the General Assembly, and it takes a lot of time. So this General Assembly, for example, we are not going to do that. So this will help us to be able to serve people who have to honor people who have served the church. So thank you for this policy. All in favor of this policy, say aye. Against or carried. Are you against? We are past that, please.
Two.
Thank you, sir. The policy document on medical bills is mentioning only church agents. What about our spouses?
It says staff.
Yes.
I can explain. Spouses of the church agent, the medical bill 11.
All right, it's okay.
Spouses, there are no spouses in. What about children also below 18? It's not covered. That's why it can be explained for us.
Yeah, moderator, if you permit me, I can explain.
Yes, please.
Yeah. I did indicate that it is the policy document that we are approving. The document itself is not here. It's a long document. It will be made available to the presbyteries. The document states clearly that the agents and their spouses and up to 3 children under the age of 18. So it is taken care of. But when you get the document in your hands, you'll be able to see all those.
Sorry, the document is not with you. Some of all have seen it. It's covered all. And it will be sent to you. Thank you. Yes.
Moderator, we are now on number
14.
14. That the church policy for clergy vestments, which include the use of stoles, again, it's a separate document and it will be made available to presbyteries today, that policy be adopted and that it will become the official policy with effect from January 1, 2021. Please amend that is 2021, not 2020. The only part of that document that is different from what was sent to the presbyteries was the fact that the clerk's official clerical is still undecided. What we did was to survey the presbyteries and the feedback that came. That's the only part that questions were asked about. So that is being thrown back to the standing committee to help determine what the clerk's official clerical shirt color will be. But beyond that, everything about vestments of clergy is in the document that is going to be in your hands soon.
Policy number 14 on vestments of clergy be adopted. All in favor say aye. Against nay. Carried.
15. That in view of the questions that keep emerging around some funeral practices, the following related policies be adopted. A. Affirm the normal burial practice of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church as burial in a grave, normally in a church cemetery, a public cemetery, a family cemetery, or where the special permit is sought in a person's home. B. Where a congregation deems it necessary to accord a member some special privilege of a burial place, it should not be done in such a way that land near the church building is compromised, making it difficult for future development. C. Whereas there are no theological reasons to prohibit cremation, cultural challenges within Ghanaian settings make it necessary for requests for cremation to be handled with care and on a case-by-case basis. Pastors should seek the consent of their presbytery moderators, who in some cases may need to consult the standing committee of the General Assembly before going ahead. In such cases, it is Christian liturgy that should be used.
Thank you. Policy on funeral practices. All in favor, say aye. Against me. Yes. That's it.
Honorable Chair, I'm saying that the current situation we are in the country now, the COVID situation, has not significant change in relation to burial practices. Where the church may not have a majority hand in burial issues. So, I would wish that the House considers this policy carefully. In the first place, some people have their families, family members buried without consent. Based on certain situations, district pastors or presbytery ministers may not be on the ground. So, we would wish that this particular policy be considered vis-a-vis the COVID-19 situation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your addition. Policy number 16.
Moderator, yes, indeed, 15 was carried.
Yes, it was carried.
I think the brother's concern is already covered here.
Yes.
Moderator, number 16. Notes with appreciation the sustainable growth trajectory on which the Kekeli Hotel currently is, and mandates the Standing Committee to study the recommendations in the Future Outlook and Policy Recommendations section of the Kekeli Hotel Report and develop implementation strategies with a view to enhancing the profitability of the Kekeli Hotel. Again, the Kekeli Hotel has given a report. That report has a particular, very progressive section called Future Outlook and Policy Recommendations. Once the Policy Drafting Committee saw it, we affirm it, we appreciate it, and felt it necessary to send that to the Standing Committee to study and come up with what is good for the trajectory that Kekeli Hotel has now for sustainable growth.
Thank you. Policy number 16 on Kekeli Hotel. All in favor say aye. Against nay. Thank you. Carried. 17.
Policy number 17. General Assembly endorses the development of the new multimedia policy guidelines as a good initiative and commend the document to the presbyteries and districts for study. The GSE should receive feedback in February 2021. On the basis of the feedback, the GSE can now process a proper decision for the next General Assembly. Moderator, I think an explanation is in place. A lot of good work has been done by people with the expertise in using modern technology to reach people, and social media and our visual technologies have just exploded. And it's very good that our team has taken the initiative to develop policies that will guide this. It's very important that a set of policies came to the policy drafting committee in the last week of our work. We endorse it. It's a good document, but we felt that it needs to go to the presbyteries for study, just like we took all the others to the presbyteries for study and feedback. So sending it back to presbyteries is not a sign of not endorsing it. Is a sign of saying we need to follow due process so that a good discussion takes place in all the presbyteries and then the feedback be fed to the General Assembly Executive Council by February so that it is the General Assembly Executive Council that will process it and bring to the next General Assembly proper decision. It does have open to it the possibility of enacting part of it before, if the GSE feels the church needs those policies long before a new General Assembly takes place. So, moderator, this is the nature of our 17th policy recommendation.
Thank you. It's as important as the rest, and I believe that is where we are now. And therefore, I appeal to all of you to endorse it for further work to be done on it. That's all in favor of policy 17, say aye. Against nay, 18.
Oh. Moderator, you'll be glad to know that we are finished. 17 was the last one.
Yeah.
From pages 6 and 7, as I indicated earlier. These are a bank of points. So if you didn't see your presbytery's point reflected in what we've already done, you may see it there, and it may be picked up by the General Assembly Executive Council or for future development. What is left for me, moderator, is to, on behalf of the policy drafting committee, thank you, thank this General Assembly for giving us the opportunity to serve our church in this way. Thank you very much.
On behalf of all of us, we want to thank you. A lot of man hours and energy has gone into doing this work. I urge you not to throw this paper away. There are a lot of follow-ups, information, because this one day General Assembly has a lot to do with this paper. And we need to follow up in our presbyteries. There's work that the Executive Council will do as monitoring what has been done. And what has been done, in fact, I don't know the words to use to thank you. This is the modern way of making decisions. If you compare it to former decision, we have to take the moderator's speech, welcome address, break into group, go back and forth, but the policy guideline, we're able to meet on all this. We sent all these reports ahead of time. So they were able to summarize, and then we're able to take out the policy issues in these reports and present it to us. This is a good, and you have made our long work very short. Thank you very much, and God bless you. We are almost on the last item. Presentation of 2019 audited accounts and 2021 budget. Do you need a break? Some people are going to. Do you need a break? All right, let's continue. Minami Chomi Jigareka. Let me have Bob Ryan. Maji Hana Mau. Eye Mada Kwenea. Me Kwele Nu. Wokata Meme. Bevie Bava. No Blan Mi Pop Bodilene. Long de son yefun e dia anu wareda na mesi o so bone no sia lunu vaina la ube long leda. Thank you very much. Be seated. Reverend Dr. Setri Nyomi's book, he already talked about it. Memos of Setri Nyomi is at the doorstep. What? How much is it? 45 cedis only. Please be seated and let's complete, because some people will be going to their various places. I now invite the auditor, the external auditor and account department, to present the auditors, the 2019 audited account to us.
Presbyter Executive, clergies, investors, ladies and gentlemen. I am pleased to present ADN Associates. I am pleased to represent ADN Associates, a firm of a chartered accountant, to present the
2019 financial statements of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Central Administration account. Mr. Chairman, permit me to read page 5
of this account. Please, page 5. Independent Auditor's Report to the members of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, Ghana, for the year ended 31st December 2019. Due to time constraint, I will read just page 5 only. Then we can go to the summary of the financial statement issue.
Okay. Yes.
We have audited the financial statement of Evangelical Presbyterian Church, Ghana, which comprises the statement of financial position as of 31st December 2019, the statement of comprehensive income and statement of cash flows for the year then ended, and note to the financial statement, including a summary of significant accounting policies. In our opinion, the accompanying financial statement presents fairly in all material respect the financial position of the church as at December 31st, 2019, and its financial performance and cash flows for the year then ended in accordance with International Financial Reporting Standard. Basis for opinion. We conducted our audit in accordance with International Standard of Auditing. Our responsibilities under those standards are further described in the auditor's responsibility for the audit of the financial statements section of this of our report. We are independent of the church in accordance with the International Ethics Standard Board for Accountants Code of Ethics for Professional Accountants, together with the ethical requirements that are relevant to our audit of the financial statement, and we have fulfilled our other ethical responsibility in accordance with these requirements and other ISBA code. We believe that the audit evidence we have obtained is sufficient and appropriate to provide a basis for our opinion. Key audit matters are those matters that in our professional judgment were of most significance in our audit of the financial statement of the church current period. These matters were addressed in the context of our audit of the financial statement as a whole, informing our opinion thereon, and we do not provide a separate opinion on these matters. Responsibilities of the General Assembly Council and those charged with governance for the financial statements. The General Assembly Council is responsible for the preparation and fair presentation of the financial statement in accordance with International Financial Reporting Standards, and for such internal controls as Council determines is necessary to enable the preparation of financial statements that are free from material misstatements, whether due to fraud or error. In preparing the financial statement, General Assembly Council is responsible for assessing the church's ability to continue as a going concern, disclosing as applicable matters related to going concern, and using the going concern basis of accounting unless Council either intends to liquidate the church or to cease operation or has no realistic alternative but to do so. Those charged with governance are responsible for overseeing the church's financial reporting procedure. Please permit me to move to page 8. Statement of comprehensive income for the year ended 31st December 2019. We have a summary of the financial statement on page 8, that's the income statement. on page 8, that's the incomes at the top and the expenditure at the down, with the reference notes to where you can find the details supporting the audited account. Just to mention a few. Income from presbyteries. Income from presbytery decreased from 5,335,720 to 4,835,620 in 2019, which represent 9% decrease over the previous year. Other assessment income was separated and introduced as a line item of 177,000 Ghana cedis in 2019. Grant from overseas. Grant from overseas increased from 2,015,938 Ghana cedis in 2018 to 3,255,441 Ghana cedis. Dividend income decreased from 26,736 Ghana cedis in 2018 to 1,592 in 2019. Interest income increased from 17,519 in 2018 to 83,436 Ghana cedis in 2019. Other income decreased from 1,356,145 in 2018 to 926,984.
Redeemed income for 2018 was 649,769, and that of 2019 was 549,089. Total income for the year 5 membership and registration decrease from 445,010 Ghana cedis in 2018 to 444,884 Ghana cedis.
Education and health institution decrease from 974,509 Ghana cedis to 965,392 Ghana cedis. Third parties activities decreased from 91,297 Ghana cedis in 2018 to 45,491 in 2019. Finance cost decreased from 32,786 Ghana cedis in 2018 to 21,311.
Good afternoon once again to our viewers. On the Lat TV Live, I am Reverend G. Jonathan Elachua from Reverend DNE for short, and we have been with you since morning during the 9th General Assembly of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana, where I said earlier in the morning that two major events are occurring and happening today. That is the election of a moderator for the General Assembly and also the adoption of the revised constitution of the church. That has been done smoothly. We had conversations with a lot of prominent people here in the church. We had a conversation with the Reverend Francis Amon, first moderator of the General Assembly of the EP Church. We had a conversation with the Reverend Frank Kwame Anku, who happens to be the last clerk of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana. After which we took, after the lunch break, we had an adoption of the revised constitution, which went smoothly. And I know you all listening and watching and viewing us today, you're all part of that. After the adoption, we did the ratification of some policies, and in due course we'll be going into these policies, explaining and getting people to explain to us, as well as the processes involved in the adoption, the review of the constitution. We'll be going into that. What is happening now on the grounds of the 9th General Assembly is the presentation of the 2019 audited accounts of the EP Church and also the 2021 budget statement. That is what is happening today. In the meantime, while we wait for that session to conclude and while it is still ongoing, we want to have a conversation with our former Presbyter Executive, Presbyter Lydia Adajawa, who is joining me today. Mama Lydia Wizo, you're welcome, Mama.
Yo, thank you very much. Asopo.
Mami.
I'm glad for the invitation.
You're all right.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for honoring the invitation. It's a pleasure for me to interview you today. In fact, I'm happy to be here with you. Mama, let's begin even from where we are. I know you do a lot on the media landscape here in the Volta region because I've heard you on radio a few occasions. How far with that? How would you rate the media here, especially in Hope? How do you rate the journalists who are on air, giving their reports and all that? How do you see them? Are they doing well?
Let me just say I congratulate them, actually, in all that they do. Occasionally, when I'm listening, and then I feel that sometimes some pronunciations are not well pronounced, some words are not well pronounced, or some expressions are not well in English, and even in Ibe, those that I'm able to consult, if I have the numbers of the people, I just call to say this. For instance, you hear people saying in so-and-so August, they mention the word, the month of August, and I just call to correct, please, it is August. And I say I'm doing that in all humility, so do please accept my correction. I'm not critiquing. I'm critiquing. That's a critique
that
we all move forward. And I think they take it in good faith. And I will say they are doing quite well because I know the media doesn't pay much.
Yes.
So when I hear them, they are here, they are over there. I wonder how they even get there. Who gives them the stipend that they need? What else can we do? I just wish that occasionally people will recognize what they do and support them.
Really. That's interesting because to us, those who sit on the fence or those who sit and watch them, to us, the media men and women are the richest because we see them and we listen to them all the time.
No.
That is the perception out there.
No. I mean, you see them. I was in the Christian Council of Ghana and I was doing many training programs and I was inviting them. So it was from there that I got to know that, they are poorly paid. People say they go for brown envelopes and whatnot. It is something that is pushing them to go for the brown envelope. So even if they do, it is our duty to see to it that such things do not continue. Just give them the little that you can. And then if it is, you have invited them for a long time, involve them in the effort, the snacks that you give and for nothing. So they feel comfortable and they go away in a very comfortable way. Sometimes you bus them to a place and they do not get back till late in the evening, you know?
Yeah.
So I think we should be up and doing and see to that this media men are properly taken care of.
Mama, thank you very much. I think we would have to look for more time to delve into the issues of the media because me, for one, I feel the media landscape here, especially in who is choked. I don't know if you see it the same way. I feel,
occasionally I see because when you invite them to something, so that a lot of people come, and sometimes you don't even invite, but they come. And I don't know if it is the place which is too small and who have trained many more people than they can employ. And I think so, because how many radio stations do we have? And how many even are paying them well? I was in the studio one day and a young guy who had finished the university with the first degree is employed, and I think he's paid about 500 CDs a month. And then I was talking to another young student of mine. I lecture at the AP University. So at the point, I was asking one of my students who had been on the screen, the sports media, I was talking here and there. So, how much are you paid? She said, I'm paid nothing.
Wow.
They are not even employed there.
Wow.
So, it means he uses the time running between school time, work, and whatnot. And she's not being paid. So, the father still supports her. Occasionally, people give her something small. I mean, So if you are not dedicated, he will not do it. No.
Okay, let's bring it back to the church. Do you think it's time we got our own radio station and possibly a TV station?
Very, very important.
Okay.
So many things go on in the church unnoticed. Unnoticed.
Okay.
Nobody covers you. Nobody says anything about you. Nobody raises any. Nothing is said about the church, especially the EPCs. Nobody. There are a lot of our people who are writing. We just read and we go ahead. I was reading something every day. Somebody was sending me something that I was reading about. A word, and then the reflections, and then the prayer points. And I was really, so I said, who is this? I was questioning. And then one day the person spoke and gave me the name of a young, and I said, but this is an EP church pastor. And he said, sure. And he, I think he's the one over there.
Okay.
And then another time, somebody also sent me something, and I heard, and they were singing a hymn, EP church. I said, who is this? So I called the lady. And she said, this pastor, and he mentioned their name, and I said, wow, let me listen. Okay. I've been listening, and I am wishing that I could be supporting them to be sending out this message to the people. Okay. It is a kind of evangelism, but it is soothing, it is creating. I mean, we should be supporting them.
Okay.
And if we can put all this thing together, create a station of the EPCs. You know, people are there. People really want to support.
Oh, yes.
We are supporting other things in other places.
Yes.
What about ours? We should be doing that in our church. So I will be glad. I'll be number one person for you to see, you with an EPC TV station, EPC studio, EP this, EPC. Me, I am born and bred inside the EPC. My parents.
Yeah,
and the way I have been trained, this, you know, this I'm from home, and this my mother said.
My
mother carried the concrete and all those things for the building. I was part of it. All of us have been part of it.
Okay.
So, for EP says, if we would, and I know if it comes to a point where there is a need to raise funds, we want people to go around looking for money, I know I'll be part of it. So I very much welcome that idea.
All right,
It's long overdue.
And then I think we should be up and doing and begin to.
Sure.
All right.
No, and so I want to even congratulate you on what you are doing right here.
All right, thank you very much. All right, we have witnessed again the election of another moderator of the General Assembly. You have been part of the administration before. Let me question you or quiz you a bit on the process. The process starts from nomination at the Pastors Association meeting. Do you think it is fair for pastors to nominate candidates for us to vote on? Do you think that is fair? Or you think it should be open to the whole church, I mean the church at last?
How I wish it could be open to the church at last, the whole church. But then the nominations will come to become too voluminous that it will be a lot of work. So we have to plan as a priority and see various paths. We don't need only the pastor because there are few leading the large group. So I think the laity should be involved. The they themselves should be involved. The pastor should be involved. But the must be strategically done in such a manner that we will have a last group of people to go from. How many people should we have as the laity? What percent of people here, there, and there, and there coming together with the pastor? Because the moderator is not leading only the pastor. The moderator is the church, the head of the whole church, including the laity and the clergy. So it is with all others. So I am thinking that if it comes to nominations, we should all be involved. It's a very sensitive point. I know. If you raise it right now, hey, there'll be halabaloo about you from the minister. But if we begin to do it gradually, it will come and the party will accept it.
Okay.
The monitor accepts everybody.
Yes.
So it should not be left to the pastors alone to see who and who and who. All of us. But then we should plan and work towards it so that it will be statistically done, so that in the end, to have the voices. Although during the voting, all people come on board, but I think the nomination can also involve others.
Mama, how well do you know the moderator elect, Reverend Agbeko? How well do you know?
This is a very difficult question. Initially, Actually, I knew him from afar.
Okay.
But when I was elected as the presidential executive, by the way, I am the first woman ever elected.
Wow.
In the history of the 194 years, 154 years of the history of the church, I am the first woman to be part of the men.
The first and only for now.
For now.
Yes. And that's an achievement, our viewers.
That's the men, yes, all the years.
That's true.
And then in 2006, I looked at myself and I said, why? What is it? One, I should be a presbyter for 10 years and I've been a presbyter for 14 years already.
Okay.
And then the second qualification is to be to hold the first degree. And I was holding the MP degree.
Wow.
So what prevents me from, and I've been a member of the church. So what prevents me from standing when the men are want to elbow us out?
Yes.
Let me go in. And can you imagine people were telling me, the road is very rough. The terrain is rough. Don't try. You can't make it.
Okay.
Anytime they said this, I say, I'm coming and I'll be able to make it.
Okay.
That was it.
Okay.
So yes, I've been part of the church. And it was from there that I saw him occasionally coming to the headquarters.
Okay.
And you know, I teach people a lot. So anytime I saw him, I said, who are you?
Okay.
I know you are Soko, but what else?
Okay.
And then I saw his credentials. So am I starting with Lieutenant Ken or something? I was that kind of doing that kind of thing for about him. And I got to know him gradually, getting nearer to him gradually. Then when he came to act, I saw him again in his acting capacity. And then there were few occasions when issues came up and we had to resolve them. And he was part of that group. So I saw the propensities in him. I thought he was going to be the military man.
Yes.
The military thing would come out of him. But you could see that he was somebody who would kind of bring some counseling sessions, trying to tone down tempers here and there, cool tempers here, make some suggestions, and I was wondering, so this man has these skills. Okay. And he's said to be a military man. Okay. And he's a pastor. Okay. So what? What else? So I wanted to know him more.
Okay.
So I was studying him. And then I think he was writing a few things that I was trying to read and follow.
Okay.
His the true identity of him as a Christian. So by what he wrote and by what I was reading, then if I'm going to go by that, and I see him as somebody who is well talented, who has has the leading of the Holy Spirit, who we can trust as somebody who can lead the church, at least for the next 6 years. Yeah. And I got to know the wife also a few years back. I don't know much about her, but I am hopeful that she will also face into it is a tough era.
Okay.
It is.
Okay.
No, they shouldn't expect it to be rosy. No. I haven't had a rosy.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you think he has what it takes to lead this church to where you want to see the church?
I think so, from his experiences. If you are a military man, it means you have gone through a lot of drillings and disciplines to be able to lead people, especially with his level of in the army. It means that he has led a lot of people. And so he should be able to lead. If people are there who take orders, you are here, I'm sure he knows that civilians are not going to take orders lying down. No. Because of the few interactions that I've had with him, there are places where you see people's anger erupting suddenly, and he wants to talk to tone it down. And then all those things are coming in, and you see that, yeah, this person, he can be provoked, I know. But as an army officer, who is provoked, you must be able to cope with the situation. Because in the army, a whole lot of things are happening. So he has risen to that side, and I'm hoping that with what I know, the little I know about him, and what he knows about the church, what the church should be, what the moderator should be. He hasn't just got here. He has gone through things from the level, various levels of the church. And it's not easy handling people. I was working with a headmaster who once said that it is easier leading sheep
than human beings. That's interesting. If you are just joining us, this is Dela TV, and this is the 9th General Assembly of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana. And what is happening now is the reading of the accounts, the audited accounts of the EPCG for the previous year, 2019, and after which we'll have the budget statement for 2021. And we're having a conversation with the former Presbyter Executive, Presbyter Lydia Adajawa, who is here with us in the studios, sharing her thoughts on a few things, and also we will be coming to her experiences when she was in office. So let's quickly go there. Mama, being the first woman, and for now as it stands now, the only woman to have served in such a position, how did you have it? Was it easy?
Thank you very much. You know, a lot of people did not know I was going to stand.
Okay.
And so it was on the day of elections that people knew. I don't even know how they knew. And then some people approached me and said, that evening, I said, you think you are also standing? And I said, yes. They didn't tell us. And I said, what for?
Okay.
Because I didn't think that I should go around campaigning. No. I just told a few people. And as soon as they got to know about it, we formed a prayer committee, a prayer team, and we began to pray. So we're praying that the will of God should be done. So that evening when people got to know, they began to ask for my picture. I said, I don't have pictures.
Okay.
Why? And they said, we want to show it to the people. Because we were 8.
Wow.
Who that were contested. You can see, so they went for the conclave.
Okay.
Where they shortlisted.
Yes.
Shortlisted 3 of us. 2 men. And myself. And can you imagine that same day, people were asking me to draw. Earlier on, people said the terrain was very rough.
Okay.
A woman would not be able to do it. As a presbyter executive, it meant a lot. So please don't come. You can't do it. And I said, I'm sorry. I was not telling them, I'm sorry, I'll be there. I'll come. And then the very last many people still came and said, just withdraw. I said, do you draw? Say yes. The next time, let me go now. Next time, I say, how do you know you'll be elected? 1, 2. And when is the next time?
Yes, that's the question.
What do you mean by the next time? I am coming. It's terrain. I say, I'm a human being. That's what I'll make it. That's also, that was what I told them. And so, and lo and behold, the election went, I think 18, 30, and then 70.
Wow.
So
that's overwhelming.
That overwhelming, overwhelming. And then there was a great, it was in this room.
Oh, okay.
Oh, Mauli School, rather.
Okay.
Mauli School. And then the Abra, wow. It was so huge. So quickly, people had to sweep me away.
Okay.
That was it.
Okay.
And getting back to work. The expectation, the right thing to be done by the church was to have got my accommodation ready.
Okay.
Where I was, where the president, former president director was, to have got it ready.
Okay.
So that January, I would have moved into that.
Yes.
But once we got to the house, it was in a mess.
Wow.
A huge mess. Wow. Nothing had been done. Nothing. No place had been swept. Everything was, if I say dirty, it's an understatement.
Okay.
They were mad. I mean,
total mess.
And then unfortunately, the roofing caving.
Wow.
Yeah. With the ceiling, the fans, and everything. And so, if people had been in that room, that I don't know what would have happened.
Yeah. Is it the same apartment where the president is?
Exactly.
Okay.
That is it.
Okay.
And The freezer, you couldn't, even if open, you would quickly close. It was nasty to look at. The floor, I don't know whether it's a floor, I don't know what they use, whether it was a carpet or whatever. Okay. If you step on it, you had a mark, a whole mark, and soles. Everything was in a mess. So, for three terms, nothing was done. Three months done. Every term, they would budget for it, but then eventually the finance officer will come and say, there's no money. The principal executive's house cannot be. So I had to look for money. I had to call friends all over the world, anywhere to invite them. So this is what's happening. Can you help me? So quickly, people gave me money. And for 1 year, we had to work on that building until it got to a position where it is now, before the new principal executive came. Yeah.
That's a great achievement.
Yes. But the work itself had been rough.
Okay.
It is true. Okay. Because sometimes you the following a day to say tomorrow we are going to the president to see the president. Mm.
Wow.
And a female.
Okay.
You had to prepare.
Yes,
the
yes.
men only put on the coat and comb their hair.
That's all.
So you had to be ready every day for anywhere.
Okay, like a soldier.
And there were times when we had to go to some places like the work for. We're doing some work with the Bidemans, self-help project.
Okay.
Typical bush.
Okay.
Can I be go to so many places and I would always in my jeans.
Wow.
I would do the walking and everything. So that was it. Then meeting people, I mean, raising funds. I remember many of our pastors' dresses were just gray or brown.
Okay.
So I decided that those were not things to be worn by my pastors.
Okay.
So I was raising funds left and right. Okay. So at that time, we had a lot of money in stock for your gowns.
All right. Thank you. We would have to wrap up this conversation. But before we leave, Mama, let me ask you finally, what are your expectations of the new moderator of the General Assembly? In other words, what do you think the church needs now in order of priority?
Right now, our finances are not good.
Okay.
So we must sit down, find a few people who have the skills and talents. What do we do to put this set back onto the track? You know, we're down already financially before the COVID came.
Yes.
And I'm surprised that they have got some money to be able to run this program.
Okay.
So where are we going? How are we going to revamp the finances of the church? Then we have talents. There are people who are talented in the church. How do we scout them, get them one together, bring them together so that they form the think tank?
Okay.
Think tank of the church. And then we can pick up from there. There are women, there are men. There are resources.
Yes.
We have a lot. We have landed property. Okay. We have so many things. So it should get the people together and begin to work. And I want him again to be sure that 2 + 2 is 4.
All right.
Never 6.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much, Mama. Thank you very much, viewers. We've had a conversation with Presbyter Lydia Adajawa, former Presbyter Executive of the EP Church. We'll wrap up the conversation now and move to take the feed from the proceedings at the General Assembly, after which we'll come back to you with another interview. Mama, thank you very much for coming. God bless you. God bless you.
When we end the assessment of a place where you have paid or you get job and then get paid, you realize that they become a little bit slow in being committed to the church's activity, especially paying time and other things, which you get as money. So the older folks who are committed are also on retirement and they are not paying much. So I wish that in looking for these financial venues, you will be very attentive to these youth and try as much as possible to monitor them so that they can also be more committed in the church activities and especially building of time and other things to help the church river. Thank you.
Thank you. The relevant one to you, you can respond to that,
is the science and data. Yes, simply put, CFC, right from its inception, kept pressing to help us. The data we want is that at the end of every year, we receive your accounts, we receive your operations, to be able to determine how far you went throughout the year. Maybe Ashanti has done it, but we are generalizing it because we are not getting this from all the presbyteries. That is the only way we can assess requests which are saying, look, our assessment is so huge, do this and do that. Don't forget that we as CFC have been looking closely at central administration's overheads. And I will tell you that we've not been very comfortable. They have not been comfortable with that because in a way we say, look, slash off this, don't do this, because the money will not be coming forth. So that is what we mean by data and science. We are expecting, looking forward, that we should be able to do a composite budget in the near future. That is putting all our presbytery accounts together, putting our budget together, and we have one voice saying that this is EP Church Ghana, this is what we are worth financially, this is what our overheads are, this is what we are looking forward to. We know the structures are not right now, but we need to start from somewhere. That is what I mean by not cutting down. I hope I've satisfied you, Ashanti. The other one, I think your presbytery monitor is there. What the youth should do to come up is up to the executive committee, not us. Yes.
Thank you. Yes.
Mr. Moderator, having just adapted the policies of the church, including the new way forward for the financials, are we still dialoguing on assessment? Because I think that going forward from January 2021, we are not using assessment going forward. We'll be using the percentages, and that by itself will tell us where and what every congregation can do. So I'm a little not too clear if we will be dialoguing on assessment in the new budget. Thank you very much.
Should I respond?
I think the policy, we're going to try alongside assessment and see how it works, because we are now going to try and see how it operates after the education that will be going on. Now we start the education. When we start the education, we start practicing it. When you pay the percentage and it's you are able to complete your assessment, maybe you continue. So I think we are going to do it alongside until we get to a point where we have to stop paying the assessment and concentrate on the percentage.
Yeah, please, can I add before Bernard comes up? The point of the matter is that, yes, we've adopted this today, right? You also have to appreciate the challenges on the ground. I know where you're coming from. I understand where you're coming from. I've talked to Reverend. If you get to the rural areas of where our churches are, personnel, you don't have personnel to really do what we ought to do and do it methodically. So we need to pilot it. And we're using this as a parameter. Once the 2021 budget is approved, and those who want to, who understand it by the training to start with their percentages, they will have, it will be an advantage to central administration. Because at 1.6, the projection I find in the paper that was sent to me, we are expecting for General Assembly Office to be able to rake in 3.1, if my figures send me right. That's positive, right? So yes, the word assessment will continue to be in our parlance until we get this sorted out. So you don't have to...
My follow-up question, sir.
Yeah.
I'm wondering how we're going to do it alongside. Because is it going to be some churches will be practicing this, other churches will be practicing that? That is my... I want to get that understanding, because on the document we were proposing that we are not going to use selected congregations on the document, unless I didn't read the document or
yes.
You didn't understand the document.
All right, I think the hands are up.
So please, let us define what the piloting is here before we go on the ground. We have 4 months to do education. This is starting 2021. We are in August. If we take off, we could cover a number. If you are committed, we could cover. But if we are pushing it forward and pushing it forward, we will dilute the momentum. My fear. Thank you.
Moderator, I can appreciate the legitimate concern of Presbyter Bernard Dadi, in as much as I agree that we have passed the policy and it must start January 2021. I think the question he's asking must be thrown back to the Policy Drafting Committee and the Central Finance Committee to come out with the implementation processes between now and December. Those concerns should be addressed by his committee and the Central Finance Committee, and by the fourth quarter, we should know our way forward. We cannot address that question here now, to my estimation, so that the two committees will come together and tell us how we should implement the policy going forward. Thank you.
Yes, 1, 2, 3. One, Very Reverend Ledo, Very Reverend Amel, and then the other. Yes. All right, Mousy, I'll come to you.
Moderator, sir. I think we have to look closely at what happened this year in terms of the COVID-19, when for almost 3 months we didn't go to church, and then the percentage assessment budgeting will definitely come from what we contribute every Sunday. In the event of a situation like this that we don't go to church, are we going to raise the percentage to support the church? So I think it is something we have to look at again, because after the assessment, whether COVID-19 or not, it is there. You know you owe it. But the percentage, you don't go to church, so it is no contribution.
That's a good one. No church, no percentage. We've taken note of that.
Let the mic work.
Maybe you can use the one here.
We are not expected to put our names.
You can come and use this one.
Back out. Moderator, please. First of all, we want to congratulate the Central Finance Committee. It is never an easy task, and particularly as a faith institution that is experiencing COVID-19 pandemic. It is true, statistically, when you go on the grounds, to the grounds in our various congregations, parishes, etc., etc., membership is nothing good to write home about. It is our prayer. It is our prayer, hopefully, that things normalize as soon as possible. But with the current challenges, and then the percentage increment we have as against 2021, somebody maybe from our lay people point of view may even be saying, why not cut our coat according to the material or cloth that we have? 2020 budget and the expenditure projections are before us. The 2021 income as against expenditure, and then the deficit at the end of the table. How do we meet these requirements in terms of the cost involved in meeting the specific items under expenditure? I want to suggest it calls for a very, very important sacrificial act on behalf of all of us, because institutions are even laying off some of their personnel. So that if we are able to take that into consideration and then manage properly, we may pass on the figures to the congregations, parishes, and districts, presbyteries for that matter. But meeting the required targeted amount would be a real challenge. It is a food for thought, so that finance, the Central Finance Committee, maybe again takes a second look and then seriously address the financial concerns in the current situation of COVID-19 in which we find ourselves. Thank you, moderator.
Thank you very much. Thank you for understanding and giving us, encouraging us to assist the central administration. If you can, then come here. Please walk here if you
can. You hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I think it's better now. Thank you, moderator and CFC, for the good work you are doing. Just to add to a very reverend's point, the first is listening to CFC. It looks like, with all due respect, the CSC doesn't seem to appreciate the devastating effect of COVID on churches' finance. For instance, I'll use my church as an example, that in a year, aside maybe raising 30,000 Ghana cedis in a month, we are also able to raise an extra amount of about 150,000 in a single year. But because of COVID, all those monies, you know, have been thrown out of the window. In essence, the entire budget of my church has been thrown out of the window. And so it looks like CFC doesn't seem to trust what is actually happening on the ground. And so the burden is upon the church or the congregation to provide the data. I'll plead with CFC to try and collect some data, you know, through the presbyteries and see what is actually happening on the ground, so that if, as very Reverend had already indicated, if there's need for review of your budget, then you'll be able to do that. Now, secondly, I glanced through the budget with my layman's lens, and I realized that the expected income is less than the projected expenditure by 13%, if I'm right. And so the question is, how are you going to fund the overrun? That is my question. And I've also realized that the redeem amount is separated from the budget. And so how are you going to collect the redeem if BCG money is too? Thank you.
Thank you, moderator. We CFC enjoys such contributions as such meetings. Number one, let me take you back to how do we finance the deficit. I did say in my presentation that we're saying that, look, the budget that we are running 2020, we will not be able to spend all. That is, we have taken into consideration all the challenges of COVID. You are asking again, CFC, we should be able to find out what is happening. And I'm saying to you that in figures, in accounting, look at where we are spread. We can only determine what is happening in your congregation if you submit your accounts through the district, through the presbytery, and we have empirical evidence before us to appreciate the deficiencies that you have. You understand us? Because we took a lot of things into consideration even getting there. But let me tell you one thing. The good news that you didn't clap for is that the moderator did say, and we worked hard on that, the rationalization and realigning salaries is the first time ever you see. At the council meeting, it was reported that you find presbyteries alongside. It's not even. But everyone has gotten something which will not be the same as you have been having. Where are we going to get the money from? Right? Even though this is a central administration's budget, the expectation that these increases will affect head of, we did say that is going to truncate to every presbytery, all agents of the church, whether you are in Nakpanduri or you are wherever, the effect of the new salary structure will come to you. And if you will be happy to earn perhaps a difference, some will drop, but I don't know where you belong unless human resource tells you. If you receive a percentage increase or a sudden increase, would you jump at it? Would you want to take it? I'm not asking you to answer, but it means that some amount of money will have to come from somewhere to pay up this additional emolument, right? So this is a very difficult challenge, but all we are urging members present is that we take on board all your concerns, but let us start somewhere. Let's see how we push on. And, you know, budgets are subject to review. Is that their estimates of our expected activities that we think we'll be performing? Depending on how we move on, we will be able to say, look, we can review it. Government even reviews budget every mid-year. So it doesn't mean that when we are put this year, we will not review. We'll review based on what we are receiving from you and looking at your pockets. And we can do plus and minus. So just don't get distressed. I always tell Ipiche that we already are defeated by saying that the money is not coming. Thank you. I'm out to leave it.
I think the last one.
Thank you very much. I need some clarification on the subvention to educational institutions. First of all, I would like to bring up this the EP training colleges. I think by Act of Parliament, all the training colleges have been converted to colleges of education. So it's no longer training colleges. So we can have to look at that particular issue. Then when I look at the subvention for various institutions, that is SHS, vocational schools, and that of the other ones, we have 3,000 allocated to each one of them. Then in the case of the colleges of education, we have two colleges of education, EP College of Education, Bimbila, and EP College of Education, Amejope. Then the subvention for them is 5,000. Does it mean that each college is taking 2,500 less than that of the senior high schools? That is the clarification I would like to know. Thank you.
I think that figure is put there. Maybe if you are lucky, you won't get it. I don't know. But the quantum is not the issue. Like you said, they can review it.
we do even more than what you have seen in the budget. Sometimes we give more. So don't be frightened by what is in the budget.
Thank you. Ongoing now is still the 9th General Assembly of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana, and the Central Finance Committee is reading the audited budget, the audited accounts of the EP Church for 2019, and then after which we'll be taking the budget for 2021. That is what is currently ongoing. In the meantime, I'll be having a conversation with two of our synod moderators here in the studios, where we will be delving much into the policies that were rectified a few minutes ago. So I am here with Osofo Lawson, Osofo Dr. Lawson Janku, and Osofo Augustine Baltus. You are welcome to the studios of Dela TV.
Thank you very much.
All right. Let me start. Osofo Augustine Baltus happens to be the synod moderator for the Central Presbytery of the EPJ. Osofo, how is your presbytery doing?
Quite good. Only with this COVID-19 period, you know, everything has turned upside down. And we have problem of getting the members back to church. Now, you see the church membership is very, very poor. And so that calls for another kind of evangelism, where a task force is formed. And the presbyters, the catechists, as well as pastors, have to go around the membership and then try to, you know, convince them that, all is not lost, yes, please come back to church. And the lazy ones will take it as the chance of relaxing. But the committed one, even during the pandemic, they want to be glued to their radio. They want to be fed with the word of God because they have a hungry soul earning for rates. And therefore, they are quick to come. We intend in Hawaii, especially. Being the biggest of all, to have two services. But so far, it couldn't work. We have to make do with the first at first, until things seem to normalize.
Osofo Dr. Lawson Janku happens to be the synod moderator for the whole West Presbytery. Osofo, by the way, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Your defense of your PhD thesis and your elevation to that high position, so to say.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
How is your presbytery doing? Is there anything different? Are people coping?
The presbytery is doing well in terms of everything, except that my story is not too different from what Osofo Augustine has said, because the COVID has come to put a blockade on our operations since March till this time. Even when we've been asked to reopen the congregations, it has become a task for people to come to church. People take it to be church holiday. So they are all this time holiday in, because they know when they come to church, they will be asked to contribute money for the development of the church. They feel very lazy to come to church. So we are trying to whip up the interest once more. We have been visiting the congregations to encourage them to open and to come to church. The pastors on the ground are charged to even visit members from house to house to tell them that church activities are bouncing back. They must also come back to church so that no hope is lost. We are in operation. The disease has come, and we believe that it will go when it's time comes. Therefore, we continue to give them the encouragement that they should come to church. We don't know when it will finally exit from our communities. So we can't wait until it goes finally before we come to church. So we must be doing life work alongside the disease. So people are encouraged from the presbytery to resume. So almost every congregation has started. going to church.
So if you are watching us live on Facebook and you are still not going to church, we want to use this medium to announce to you that church has started. Please, COVID-19 yes. has come to stay with us. So yes. we need to learn to live with the disease. So please go to church on Sunday because of church service. Now continuing, our main task here is to discuss the policies that have been ratified this afternoon. And there are a few, but then let me take the first one with the new financial policy of the church. Also for Django, what do you make of this new percentage system as against the assessment system? Your initial reactions to this?
Looking at the new policy, we believe that it may work maybe better than the old system because you need to harness all assessment, bring it to headquarters so that salaries are paid from there to the congregations, the agents of the church. One thing I have seen as a challenge with the new system is the honesty on the part of congregations and our treasurers and agents who are managing the finances of the churches, provided they will be honest enough. If they will not play the Ananias and Sapphira's, it will be a good policy. But I'm afraid that people, the way I know our people, we haven't put all this money together and you tell them to send this percentage to the headquarters, keep this with the presbytery and keep this for the congregation. People are of the view that any money they contribute in their chapel belongs to them. Therefore, parting with a percentage to some other department of the church is a problem already.
Okay.
So that is where my fear is.
Okay.
But if all will be honest enough to submit all that we have contributed in church, it will be a good policy to drive the church forward.
That was actually one of the questions I had wanted to ask the Ananias and the Sapphira part.
Okay.
But before I go to Osofo Baltus, viewers, let me read to you what we have in the new financial policy. What is supposed to happen from January 2021 is that 60% of all Sunday tithes and offerings, pledges and harvest proceedings will remain at the congregational level. So 60% is remaining with the congregation. For parishes, all the 60% stays with the parish. For others, 10% will go for the administration of the district and 50% remain for the local congregation. Now moving from there, 33% will go to the General Assembly office, and out of that we have 13.5% for General Assembly expenditure and 19.5% for church agents and General Assembly office personal costs. Now 13.5% of all Sunday tithes, pledges and harvest should be sent through the presbytery to the General Assembly. This will cover some other things that I have here. 7% will go to the presbytery. That 7% of tithes and offerings, pledges and harvest proceedings should be sent to the presbytery for its expenditure. So that is a summary of the new financial policy the church will be operating for January 2021. Also for Baltus, how do we, or what should we do beginning from now to help curb this issue of Ananias and Sapphira, where the congregations will not be playing truancy and keeping part of the money and declaring just part of it? What do you think we should be doing from now?
Thank you very much for that opportunity. The truth of the matter is, just as my colleague pastor said, there is need for integrity in this matter. If we have to be very true to ourselves, this system will be the means by which the EP Church will be saved from its financial woes. There is need now for education to start right away, so that before the implementation in the coming year, then enough education has gone into it. so that those people who think that, oh, as for the first collection is welfare, it's not subject to any division.
Okay.
The appeal, special appeal is towards this. It's not subject to any, you know, sharing and all that. Leaving only the offering which is given assembly. Then it means that the system is going to collapse. It will be worse off than what the quota system used to operate. So we have to be educated and then see the need that we have to make sure that we share it according to the new proposal. The other point which I want to add quickly is that oftentimes our congregations undertake projects without resource clearance from the head office or even the presbytery. It is these things which lure them to be putting something aside. Those projects are very dear to them, more than contributing to the total overall cost or well-being of the church. And this is where the Ananias and Sapphira place come in. So every project that they have to undertake must be sanctioned on giving the go-ahead by the highest authority. Otherwise, the project will make them to become lies and they will not through to the new system. And then the integrity side of it is what we desire. Without it will work. Just say, fifth one, somewhere, sometime in the
sun. All right.
And the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you all. I now invite Reverend Dr. Benaina to lead us in the epilogue.
Thank you, moderator. And so we begin the epilogue in the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Shall we sing the hymn 313, 313, the first and second stanzas only? 313. Standing, please. For the last. Shall we be seated, please? Sisters and brothers in Christ, by God's grace, we have made great progress through this 9th General Assembly, and we ought to give thanks and praise to God. By God's grace, we have a moderator elect. By God's grace, our constitution has been promulgated. By God's grace, we have a manual of order to guide us. By God's grace, we have a set of policies to guide our work for this new General Assembly year. By God's grace, we have a budget to guide our income flow and expenditure. We give God thanks for all these. And we give God thanks that He has made this one day General Assembly very successful. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 2, which is one of the texts for or undergirding our General Assembly theme, is saying that now it is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful.
We are taking the epilogue, which is led by the Reverend Dr. Ben Nyman. We have in the studio, so I'm so privileged to have with me the moderator of the General Assembly of the EPJ, the Right Reverend Dr. Seth Senu Agidi, who will be sharing with us a few of his thoughts on proceedings so far during the General Assembly. Also, for you are welcome, Doctor.
Thank you.
All right. Daddy, how does it feel to be ending your term soon? We have just elected a new moderator of General. How does it feel?
Mixed feeling, but excited. Looking back from where I started and the challenges that I faced, especially during my sickness, the challenges I have to be nursing myself and then doing the work as well. Electing a new moderator has given me the signal that I'm coming to an end of my work officially, but still a member of the church. And therefore, I am excited to pass on the leadership baton to another person, and praying that the good Lord who led me to this place will continue to lead as well.
Thank you very much. You started your term, I am sure, with a lot of goals, aspirations, and visions for the church. Would you say you were able to execute all or most of them?
Well, nobody can execute all. But I think, looking back, we have done very well. Most of the things that I was thinking that we need to do, we have done them. When I came to office, one of my goals is that we have to enact the right policies to strengthen the foundation of the church. Because when, as a pastor, I realized that we have been doing a lot of things haphazardly, and also everybody comes with this policy, and when he leaves, he goes with him, and all other things. But during my then office, we have been able to enact a lot of policies to strengthen the foundation of the church. The financial manual, strategy plan, the first of its sorts, and a whole lot of policies have been enacted to lead us. So I think I'm satisfied.
All right. Would you say the position of the moderator of the General Assembly is that of enjoyment?
Oh, wow. In Efe, we say, Adwa Vianya.
That's interesting.
It has never been enjoyment for me.
Okay.
When I was coming, it is a duty. I want to serve. I want to serve the church. And I want to help in that policies. I want to be somewhere that can be very influential in making certain things. That's my goal. So when I came, I didn't think an enjoyment. I don't think so. I've been busy 24/7. I sleep with the church, and I wake up with the church. And I've been busy and all that. So, but when we talk of enjoyment, I enjoy to serve. I will say that. But not that kind of enjoyment that we have in the secular world and say that I am a leader, or in the political arena where our presidents and all this to enjoy the wealth that they gain out of being in office. Not that kind of thing.
Which of the days or which occasion would you describe as the saddest for you during your tenure as a moderator of the General Assembly of the EP Church? Saddest?
The saddest?
Yes, sir.
Well, I don't think that you ask me a question like that, so.
Okay.
Of the saddest, Of recent memory, the loss of the Clerk General Assembly's wife, it has been a blow to all of us, and I think we have not recovered yet. So if you talk of the saddest, I'll think of that. And I will align that with the loss of our former Clerk of General Assembly, Osiakwa, who I worked with 1 year, and also Jojoji, who I worked also with about 2 years. So those are the saddest moments.
Okay. And what would you see, or what of the occasion would you see and say you are, that gives you satisfaction? What gives you satisfaction now that you are leaving office?
Oh, a day like this.
Okay.
No. All General Assemblies are days that I like to have, because I see the church coming from east to west, north and south, gathering, and all of them trying to help make decision for the forward march of the church. So I enjoy seeing everybody contributing, sacrificing, and do all that. This is some of the days that I enjoy very much.
All right. Now that you are almost leaving office, what do you think the church needs at this time moving forward?
Well, again, we need policies. We need to enforce the strategy plan so that our development could be planned very well and executed. We need mobilization of funds in order to pay our debts and to put into other things. These are the key areas which we need to focus on.
Do you think the Reverend Dr. BDK Agbepo has what it takes to take the church there where you want to see it in the future?
Well, I didn't appoint him.
Yes.
It's God who appoints him.
That's true.
If he also realized that, then he has what it takes. But if he's going to rely on his wisdom, his knowledge, his strength, his degrees, then there'll be a problem. There'll be a big challenge. So I think he has what it takes, because it's the Lord who appointed him through us. I've worked with him for some time when I was sick. He deputized for me. So that's one of my joys as somebody who have a hand in mentoring him to know what the office looks like before it was endorsed by the General Assembly.
So what words would you have for him in form of advice now that he's taking over the administration of the church?
Well, he must be very focused, humbled, and take every member seriously in the church. As Presbyterians must work through the grassroots to the top. If he takes our congregation seriously, he visits them regularly and makes sure that the decisions of the Executive Council and the General Assembly, the policies, monitoring, then you will be very, very successful.
And finally, before you take leave of us, I know it's been a very busy day for you. What will be your words to our viewers who are watching us across the world, and to even people who have been here in this General Assembly? What would be your last words to them, sir?
Well, EP Church is 173 years old. This is our time. We have everybody at a stake in the mission of the church. Wherever you are, you must play your role. Do not just watch or listen. We need your support by way of advice, finances, to help the church. The EP University, we need a lot of money in order to make it stand on its own. We are rich. We have the resources. But it's only a few people who are paying attention to releasing the resources and making themselves available. And therefore, if you are watching, wherever you are, this church has made many of us who we are today. By the mission of the the first missionaries, we have access to go to school, the Presbyterian schools. We have churches in all the communities, and also, so we also have to leave something for generations unborn to come and benefit. So what are we doing now? At this time, we have built a university. We must make sure that it stands. That is what we are, our contribution and others. So wherever you are, please do not just say amen to our words and preaching and say they are doing well. We want you to participate in a very meaningful way so that the mission of the church can continue to be visible, so that we'll be able to leave legacies down for generations to come.
Thank you very much. If you are just joining us, we were having a conversation with the moderator of the EP Church, the Right Reverend Dr. Seth Senyo Agidi. And we'll be taking a break after which we would have some synod moderators joining us, and we'll be discussing some of the policies that have been rectified. Also, thank you very much for joining
us. You're welcome.
Thank you so much, sir.
You're welcome.
All right. So at this point, I would bring in some other synod moderators who will be joining us to discuss some of the policies that we have just ratified. And the ratified mean we've amended or signed to use them officially as a church. There are quite a few, about 17 of them in all. We were discussing with the Osofu Baltis and Osofu Janku the new financial policy of the church, where I read to you from that document which we have, where 60% of all that is the income from the congregations are supposed to remain with the congregation, and other percentages, respective percentages, going to the presbytery, to the headquarters, and to the district. So let me just do a recap of that. So at the congregation level, we have 60% of the Sunday tithes and offerings, pledges and harvest proceedings will remain at the congregational level. For parishes, all the 60% stays with the parish. For others, 10% will go for the administration of the district, and 50% remain for the local congregation. Then 33% will go to the General Assembly office. And out of that, 13.5% will be for the General Assembly expenditure, and 19.5% will be for church agents and General Assembly office personnel costs. Now, the 13.5% for the General Assembly office expenditure will be sent through the Presbytery office to the General Assembly. This will cover the following: 1, General Assembly salaries and personal costs; then 2, the EP University subventions; 3, Trinity Theological Seminary subventions; Peki Theological Seminary subventions; 5, ecumenical commitments and annual fees, that's to the WCC, the WCRC, the AACC, the CCG, and the rest. Number 6, it will be the General Assembly Council meetings and other committee meetings. Number 7, the money will be set, part will be set aside for General Assemblies. Then number 8, operational running costs and General Assembly office responsibilities. Number 9, other General Assembly expenditure. And 10, for contingency, on which the General Assembly can draw for emergencies and giving aid to poorer congregations in their development projects. Then the 19.5% will be for salaries and related charges of church agents. And this would be added to the amount to be sent to the General Assembly office through the presbyteries. Number 7% will go to the presbyteries. And that will be, so 7% of the tithes and offerings, pledges and harvest proceedings should be sent to the presbytery for its expenditure. And this will include presbytery financial responsibilities and other emoluments. Money set aside for presbytery meetings, and 3, presbytery projects; 4, presbytery executive activities; and 5, as contingency, on which the presbytery can draw for emergencies and giving aid to poorer churches in their development projects and new congregations planted by the presbytery. Now I am joined by 2 other synod moderators, that is the Reverend Jandu Hedido and Reverend Dr. Akoto, Meridian Presbytery and South Volta synod moderators respectively. We will be having a conversation on the other policies. Maybe we'll take two out of the lot, and other synod moderators will come, then we'll discuss the rest. Osafus Miawezo, you're welcome to our studios here at the Latin. We were having a look at the new financial policy, which will take effect from January 2021. So I would like to move on with the other policies that we have just ratified. That's the next one. That is, let me read. It said that the relationship between the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana and the Presbyterian Church of Ghana be strengthened to include a high-level bilateral regular meeting at least once a year. Two, joint program seminars to address national issues as a contribution from reform perspectives. C, strengthen the nature of participation in general assemblies. D, invitations to one another to attend one another's presbytery level synods and meetings. And E, pulpit exchanges. This sound interesting. Also, for Roger, let me start with you. Do you think this is feasible in the first place?
It should be feasible, I think. We have been partners for quite some years now. And this should not even be said. We just need to work around it to strengthen the relationship between us in the ways listed here below, as we have read. So for me, it should be feasible if we work hard or harder at it, because we have been partners some time now, as I've said already.
Thank you. Also for Dr. Akoto, what would you say to people who say, okay, if this is what we want to do with the Presbyterian Church of Ghana, then we should have everything operating the same way? And the people give specifically, let me go to that, specifically the tenure of presbyters in our church. Some say the Presbyterian Church elects presbyters for 4 years, one term, another 4 years, another term, then you don't go again. But we have presbyters for up to 80 years thereabouts. So if we want to have a relationship, a bilateral relationships and others with the president, then we should do the same thing. What should you say to such people?
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much for the opportunity given us. It's true that this relationship that is being proposed by our church is a good one. And we believe that we will achieve it too. But coming to the question, yes, it's true that we are Presbyterian tradition. But I will not say that they started the General Assembly concept for some time now. And we are nine years in this. So you see that we want to at least start in a small way, observe it and practice it so that we can also achieve what they have also or gone through. So to me, let's stick to ours. Let us not just say that the presbyters, they go for a term and they were given out. Let's observe this one for some time. And since the policy, we can revise it some years to come. That's what I'm saying.
All right. Thank you very much, Reverend Doctor. Sofu Janju Hedido. The E here, pulpit exchanges. Practically, how do you think this will operate? How would it work? Is he a district minister exchanging pulpit with another presbyter district minister? Or how would it be?
I want to believe that is how it should be, because I think our doctrinal practices are just about the same. And so something like this shouldn't be a problem if we want to carry it out the way we do it at our individual levels. I mean, as EP Church and then as the Presbyterian Church of Ghana. So, yes, even lay preachers, the exchange pulpits, if we sit and plan well, as I've said. Yes.
Okay. Also for Janzu again. I see this confusion amongst our congregants at the congregation level and the rest. When you say synod moderator and you say moderator of General Assembly, they always want to say, they want to refer to him or them as moderators. And there's this confusion. Do you think we should start considering changing the names of synod moderators to presbytery chairpersons?
They had been known as such formally. I think this synod moderator tag came about when we switched off the General Assembly concept. And so once there is a distinction by saying synod moderator and GA or General Assembly moderator, the difference should be clear enough. And so I don't think we would have to revert to the old system. No.
Osofo Akoto, so how do you think we can solve this confusion? how can we solve the clear the minds of our members so that they would maybe go along with the wind?
Yeah, what is happening? As my brother has said, in fact, we started with a synod chairman. In fact, initially, that is how we have given it out. But when we come to the synod, and then from synod to the General Assembly, in fact, we wanted to copy from the Presbyterian system. I believe that the Scottish one, that's what they wanted to copy from. So we are using it as the moderator of the synod. Moderator of the synod. We normally educate our people. We let them know that, yes, that is the trend. That is the structure. So they should make use of it like that. And they are comfortable with it now, at least. They are comfortable.
Okay, thank you. The next policy that I have here is the General Assembly adopts the decisions of the Bremen Mission Women's Pre-Assembly held in March 2019 in Ghana regarding gender-based violence as follows. A. Denounce the acts of violence and abuse and urge that perpetrators be brought before the law. B. Provide safe spaces for victims, that's women and children especially. C. Set up telephone or internet counseling or a helpline. D. Train church leaders and agents properly on gender-based violence, noting that gender-based violence is sometimes perpetrated against men also. Also for Akoto, my view is this, or the question is this. You see, most of the people who are gender activists now in the system are women.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think men should venture into this area, and do you think that will help?
Yeah, according to one of the women I discussed this issue with yesterday, she told me that when they are talking about gender, it sounds they are referring to only women and children. They said it's holistic, it's made up of men, women, and children. You see, so gender, generally, for us to let the people know that they are only taking care of the all of us. Both men, women, and the children. How will check those things in the society? At least perpetrators against crime and violence in the society have to check those things. That is all that they are trying to do. Yeah.
So men should be involved?
Yes, men should be involved.
Okay.
Men should be involved.
All right. Sofuruja, I saw a very interesting video circulating on social media, specifically WhatsApp, a few weeks ago, where a lady was paid by someone to actually sleep with a madman on the street. Mm. And the lady did it and she was paid. Do you think this constitutes gender violence in any way or so?
I was actually going to say that violence should be looked at holistically.
Okay.
And that we should not zero in to any particular gender.
Mm.
Because men could be involved, even as we can find at the tail end of the policy.
Mm.
And so what you have just said could be seen as, because there should be an underlying intention for what the woman was paid to do.
To do.
Yes.
Mm. Okay. Yeah. All right. Thank you very much, viewers. If you are just joining us again, I am having a conversation. I am Reverend D.N. Ephraim. I'm having a conversation with Reverend Roger Jandu Hedido, who is the Synod Moderator for the Meridian Presbytery. And I also have here in the studios of Dela TV, the Reverend Dr. Akoto, who is a South Volta Presbytery Synod Moderator, also here with us. Let's take one more policy, then I will allow it to go, and I'll bring in other Synod Moderators. And this has to do with the funeral practices.
Mm-hmm.
There is still this, you know, we also need to look at the culture in which we find ourselves. Yeah. How do you think this is going to go down well with our congregants? The issue, I'm talking especially about the issue of, which one is that?
Cremation
or so forth, yes. The issue of cremation. How do you think this will go down well with our congregants?
When you digest the policy carefully,
mm.
you realize it is just down to earth.
Mm.
So we just have to educate our members, explain this policy to them very carefully.
Mm.
And I think they will also understand
and
allow for it to stand. But of the truth, there definitely shall be initial challenges because of our cultural background.
Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Also, yeah. Fakutu, yes. What are you
in our discussion in the presbytery level, a lot of people raised this alarm concerning the cremation. And I told them that in our liturgy, there is a word in the mention, afi, nenye, afi, joafi, afi. And that actually let us know that, in fact, we are dash. So you cannot bury somebody and you produce the dust though. But you can burn. You can cremate the person and get the ash. So when I explained to them, they actually came to that realization that yes, it's possible. It's possible. And you know, through accidents and all those things, it happened like that. In our traditional sector, when there's an accident or there's a fire outbreak and people evicting somebody die like that, they normally go and gather the ash and then bury. So we only go along with that and then that's all.
Okay.
They will take it.
Right. So Afram,
Papa,
you realize that in the liturgy which we use, we really don't have afi.
Yes.
In the pronouncement that we make, we have
that's right.
But I think with the understanding of the other implication as well, anyway. But if we do cremation, where definitely dust to dust and ash shall be pronounced, then I think the thing becomes a little more holistic so far as the pronouncement is concerned. So as I have said already, we just have to educate our members. And I think the policy is down to earth, as I said earlier on. That we must do it case by case. So we don't just get up and allow for it to prevail because it has become a policy. By so doing, I think our people will understand and get along with us. Yes.
Finally, on this same cremation issue, there is a portion that members are supposed to sign in our membership booklets, which talks about if I die, bury me according to the practices of the church. So should a member sign that, and as it stands now, as of now, the policy of the church is you are buried in the cemetery. Should somebody sign that, and after he dies, the family counts that we want to cremate. As a minister, should I go ahead and cremate when the person signs that I should be buried according to the practices of the church? Should I go ahead and do it?
Now that this is becoming a policy for us, then it implies that it is part of what is being signed.
All right.
So as has been carefully spelled out, you just have to do this in consultation with your presbytery executive, who may also consult or may also have to consult the standing committee. Carry on whatever there is to be done.
Viewers, we've been having a conversation, as I said earlier, with the Reverend Roger Jandu Hedido, Synod Moderator for the Meridian Presbytery, and the Reverend Dr. Akoto, Synod Moderator for South Volta Presbytery. Thank you very much for coming, moderator.
Thank you.
I would like you to take your leave now, and we'll have others and continue. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
there were not so many arguments like in, we had in the past, where for one policy you have a lot of questions, and all these have been done at the presbytery level, and their inputs have been made into this, and so I'm sure it helped, so that the, even though the thing was sparked, in the end we have been able to go through a number of things that we have been scheduled for today.
What does the adoption of a new constitution mean for the church? What does it mean for the church?
Yes, definitely it means that there's an end to the 2010 General Assembly Constitution.
Okay.
And so as we speak now, it becomes obsolete. Nobody can use it any longer. We have a new constitution. And so if you want to make any references, you have to fall on that constitution. Mind you, as far as a constitution is promulgated and adopted, whether you have the copy or not, it's binding on you. That's
right.
The law.
That's
and
right.
So whether you have a copy of that constitution or not, everything in that constitution is binding on all of us. It becomes our responsibility now to look for copies of those the constitution.
What are your expectations of the new moderator of the EP Church, or moderator-elect, the Reverend Dr. Lieutenant Colonel Retired B.D.K. Agbeko? What are your expectations of him?
Well, in summing up everything, I expect that there will be an improvement on the gains of the church. Some people have started something already, and so we expect that we see improvement in every facet of the life of the church, especially in areas of evangelism and financial administration.
Viewers, this has been the live coverage of the 9th General Assembly of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church, taking place at the Evangelical Presbyterian Church Ghana Hokpoji. And we are bringing to you a wrap of all the events that have taken place today, and we are ending. And I have been your host, the Reverend G. John Nathaniel Achua, from, you can call me Reverend DNA for short, and I'll respond. I have been here co-hosting with me, has been with the Osofo Bright Mawiena. Osofo, thank you very much for the day. It's been quite a busy day. So please join us again, and if you want to ask any questions, support this program in any way, you can put your comments in the comment box. Catch you again next time. Been Reverend DNA from some other time. Bye-bye for now. Captain of